Hi, I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer. The recent train derailment in Ohio that spread toxic chemicals over an entire town has more and more people calling out Transportation Secretary Buttigieg. We're going to explain why he's a target. Microsoft is having a world of problems with their new artificial intelligence bot that has started comparing journalists and other people to Hitler and Pol Pot. And a weird trait of Donald Trump's could prove that he understands more human psychology than most politicians. All that and more, it's coming up. Don't go anywhere. America's Lawyer starts right now. Donald Trump has a new nickname for Ron DeSantis, and there might be a good reason why he does this. Ring of Fire's Farron Cousins joins me to talk about what's happening, and along with a lot of other topics. But this Meatball Ron, now I've heard two different versions. Some are Meatball Head Ron, Meatball Head, and the other was Meatball, just regular Meatball Ron. First, it's usually the first step we see Trump take where it comes to attacking his opponent, and there's a good reason he does it. People might be saying he's crazy, which he is. He's obnoxious, which he is. He's vulgar, which he is. But he has a political reason, doesn't he? Go ahead and talk about it.
He really does. And this is actually a very interesting story because it does show that the one thing Trump is good at is getting people. And he knows that people, same thing you and I have been talking about for 20 years now, the American public has very short attention spans. So if you can capture that attention for any period of time, whether it's with a stupid little nickname or a catchy slogan, you've got them. Like, that's all you need. And that's why these other nicknames he has, like, Crooked Hillary is still something you see. Lion Ted Cruz. Plenty of people on the left still use Lion Ted Cruz. Those are all nicknames that Trump came up with. And he, as far as we know, has never publicly said Meatball Ron. But everybody in the media has now used that phrase.
It's out there. We're going to talk about that. It's out there. Now, he was smart enough to put it out there and said, oh, I'm not going to call him that. It's all over. I see Meatball Head and Meatball. I don't know which one's going to stick, but I see emojis with Meatball Head, and you name it. But, I mean, it kept with Sleepy Joe. You know, Sleepy Joe Biden, Little Marco.
Yeah.
Little Marco definitely stuck. So you mentioned the attention span. It's more complicated than that. When you really take a look at why the shrinks are saying this works, they're saying that at this point in time, the average American has a reading and a comprehension ability of about a 6th to 7th grader. So they're always going to gravitate towards the easiest thing. So Meatball Head here, Trump may not call him Meatball Head. But at this point, we're already seeing it. We're seeing it in social media. We're seeing comments that are coming out where they've got emojis with Meatball Head. So he's really kind of accomplished what he wants to say. Here's what's really important, I think. The shrinks say it's all about placing a visual with a word. In other words, if I put a bunch of words up here, if I put 50 words, and I said, can you memorize those words? Probably couldn't do it as well as if I put a picture with the word. If you saw a lion and I had a picture of a lion, dog, picture of a dog, you're gonna be able to memorize that better. Your success in memorizing that. That's what's happening here.
It really is quite fascinating, to be honest. And again, I know it's juvenile, it's silly, but it has worked for him so well. That's the same reason that, you know, they shortened up the Make America Great Again into just MAGA. Because it's simple, it's quick, it's easy. It's almost a slogan at this point. Mm-hmm. Same thing with these nicknames. You know, Meatball Ron is now a slogan. Mm-hmm. Just like if you heard Hot Pockets or By Menon. Those are things that people remember. It's short, it's quick, it's to the point. And it is a branding corporate thing. And that is one thing that Trump understands better
branding.
Than anybody.
Trump, you know, the whole Trump empire has been branded by. But what he was looking at, when you look behind the story, when people say, well, what was really up here? Well, he's trying to capture, I don't know DeSantis. I've never met DeSantis. But apparently he does have kind of a pudgy, fat head in a pudgy body. So when he's talking now, as people are watching him, they're doing that thing that I just talked about. They're associating a word with a picture. And he might be delivering really important things. I'll tell you where I'm already seeing it. Really weird. We're already seeing it. Right now, DeSantis in Florida is trying to take away consumers' rights to sue insurance companies when their house is destroyed by a hurricane. He's trying to limit what they can do. He's trying to really beat them down. Consumer organizations are really mad about it. I'm already seeing Meatball Head out there by those consumers. Now, those are people who ordinarily probably would have supported the guy. But now they got this tool. And we're going to see Colbert.
Yeah.
Didn't Colbert do the same thing?
He had a whole song that they sang about Meatball Ron the other night. So this is something that has now made it into pop culture. Right. And again, it all happened with Trump never having to say it publicly, just having it leak out that he's considering. And prior to that, actually back in November, he was considering calling him Potato Boy was going to be the nickname. But I got to say, Meatball Head sticks a lot better than Potato
Boy.
Well,
I think it's a problem. It may sound, if you look at the history of it, it is a problem. For DeSantis. And I don't know how you overcome something like, you know, every time somebody sees you, they think Meatball Head. I mean, I think it's a problem. Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg is over his head. We've been saying this so long, haven't we? The string of derailments now after the airline disaster. I don't know what it takes. I think the word derailment, it's almost a metaphor for Buttigieg right now. Here's what bothers me about it. Obama tried to solve this problem. He knew that we were a century behind in technology dealing with braking systems on trains. So he said, let's put this in place. And he had it working. And then Trump comes in, does away with it. But 5 years later, almost 5 years later, Buttigieg has done nothing. He's done nothing, even though the previous administration laid out what the problem was and said, this is a big problem.
And you know, 3 or 4 days after that big derailment in East Palestine, Ohio, he goes on cable news. They talk to him. They do a whole interview with him. Not once do they mention that train derailment. Not once did they mention the big toxic cloud over that city. And this was days after it happened. He had not yet made a public statement about it. And that was actually The Nation did a phenomenal article talking about how this guy doesn't get it. He had to be forced publicly and shamed into finally even addressing that this thing happened.
Why is the media and why is the Democratic Party protecting him? I mean, is it, you know, the first thought you have, well, he's gay. Nobody wants to attack him because he's gay. The truth is, there are hundreds of gay politicians and people in bureaucracy that could do this job very competently. So it's not that. I mean, you have to call it out what it is. You can't just get hung up on the fact that he's gay. Well, he's gay, okay? Big deal. There are plenty of gay people that would do a fantastic job with what he's doing. But it's like non-speak that you hear the politicians, it's non-speak. That the media is just so afraid to talk about this. He's an incompetent boob. He needs to be gone, man.
Well, it reminds me a lot, you know, when we would criticize Hillary Clinton whenever she did something wrong, people would say, well, you're being sexist. Yeah. It says, no, well, you're ignoring the actual argument here.
Yeah.
But what we have seen in just the last 12 months, forget the last 24 months that he's been in office, the last 12 months, we have seen them break up the rail worker strike, that part of it was about this issue.
Good point.
We have seen the massive meltdown in the entire airline industry over Christmas and Thanksgiving.
With this administration.
With him as transportation. Yeah. We saw the supply chain fiasco. You know, that's all under his leadership. He may not have caused the problems, and I've said that. He didn't cause the problems. But he is not equipped, he does not have the wherewithal to address these crises, these multiple crises that his office has faced. If this were somebody from the Trump administration, we would have been doing segments on it every day.
Absolutely.
Everybody in the left would have, calling for his resignation. And I think we should be at that point. He can't do the job.
Okay, so what we hear is, oh, well, it's the CEOs of the companies. the CEOs of the airline company, the CEOs of the rail company. No, it's his job to make sure they do their job. He's been here for more than 4 years now, and he, I mean, it just is not happening. It's just not happening. You know, here's the problem. The problem, I said 4 years, that's not accurate. Yeah, it's three and a half years. So, but the point being, he was here. Here's what I was trying to get to. He was here when we had a Democratic House, Democratic Senate, Democratic president, and he had already been told by a Democratic president, Obama.
Well, and Merkley in the Senate said him.
Right. He had been told this is a problem. So deal with it. Don't go on vacation or wherever the hell he disappears to. Deal with it. I just think they need to get rid of him. I just think he's a disaster. And it's like, you know, I'm tired of hearing, gee whiz, it's not his fault. It's the CEO's company. That is a ridiculous argument when you consider that his job is to regulate.
Well, and look, the CEOs, their hands are not clean, but we talk about that all the time. Yeah. We're well aware of that. Trump, yeah, he repealed the Obama-era rule, which was already not very good.
It was at least in the right direction.
It was, Farron. Which was a lot what we saw under Obama. It wasn't quite where it should have been, but it was a good step forward.
Yeah, he was trying. We had a president who was trying to fix the problem.
But we had, during the Obama, the early years, we had so many train derailments that they started to refer to them as bomb trains.
Yeah.
There was a great reporter that I worked with at the Smog Blog, Justin Makoka. He was writing about train derailments and explosions nearly every day. Mm. And that's why Obama finally put that rule in place, because we knew how dangerous they were. We're using the braking system that we used during the Civil War.
Yeah.
I mean, same system.
And they have a replacement that's used all over the world. They use it in Asia. They use it in Europe. It's an electric pneumatic system. Isn't that kind of how you describe it?
Yeah, that all the cars at once.
It's electric pneumatic. The industry knows about it. They know how to make the adjustments and put it on ours. It's used, as I say, all over the world, except here. And this numbnut has been here, let me correct it again, only 3 years, not 4 or 5, like I said.
And that's the big issue. You can spread the blame if you want to say the CEOs. We know what they did. We know what Trump did.
Dirty operators.
But he also knew what they did, knows what they do. He could have solved this problem. He could have put it in motion to get back to where we had been under Obama. He failed to do it. He failed to take action on the airliners. He let them do what they're doing. You know, failed us on the supply chain. Just failures across the board. There's not a single accomplishment this man has done.
Why is corporate media giving him a free ride? In your opinion, why? I'm interested to know. Am I just so far off on the fact? I just think they're afraid to criticize him because he's gay.
I think they're afraid to criticize him because they think he's going to be the 2024 Democratic nominee.
Oh, good Lord. Let's hope not for the Democrats, because I'd love to see some Democrats win. The Biden administration has sided with the company responsible for the Ohio train derailment in a lawsuit that could make it harder to sue corporations. I don't understand this. What the hell? Why is Biden sending his Justice Department to argue on behalf of Norfolk Southern Railroads? In a nutshell, what they're trying to do, they're trying to say right now, if somebody's injured, they can bring a lawsuit in various jurisdictions. It's called forum shopping. They say, I'm injured here. These courts are usually, the law's better for us. The statutes are better. We like the judge's rulings. We're going to go here to bring the case. Norfolk wants to say, no. You can only bring this in Norfolk, Virginia. That's their argument. And the Supreme Court has that question right now.
Yeah, and the Biden administration went to court. They didn't have to.
No,
and that's what everybody has to understand. They voluntarily went to court and made the argument that, yes, we support Norfolk Southern's lawsuit here. We agree with them. The consumers, you know, should not be allowed to sue, because if the company is based in Virginia, they got to sue in their hometown,
right,
where they've probably paid off every, you know, judicial campaign there.
But, well, I don't know if they paid off judicial campaigns, but they pay off politicians.
They spread all the money around. And we have seen, you know, a lot of these, some of the local elections, because not all judges are elected, but there's plenty of them that have taken Norfolk Southern money. But what the issue is here is, you got a man that had cancer. He was working with the train company, but he's working down in Georgia. So he gets cancer and he says, okay, well, I'm going to sue where I get the cancer because that's where I am. That makes the most sense.
By the way, the law's better there. The statutes are better. Yeah. Anyway, go ahead.
And so Norfolk Southern says, no, because we're based in Virginia, you have to come to where we are, even though it's our toxins that came all the way down to you. Mm-hmm. And this could be used across the board. This is not just a Norfolk Southern issue. This is something, I mean, think about all the cases you've done with mm-hmm. this environmental toxin mm-hmm. that has spread throughout a waterway. And imagine if you had to go to the home, you know, of Dow and try it right there in their backyard. Well, it's a lot more difficult.
We've seen this Biden administration, Department of Justice, side up almost continuously with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, with associated industries, with big business. Every time it's big business versus the consumer, Biden sends in his dogs, the Department of Justice, to argue, well, let's argue for big business. That's what this is all about. Look, it's just common sense. We know up in Virginia where they'd have to go that they've got limited liability. They make it very difficult for the consumer, for the injured victim. Limited damages, unfavorable case law, bad statutes. They have all of that. That's why Norfolk Southern wants them in their backyard. It's a dangerous, dangerous thing. And what if we have an absolute catastrophe like we're seeing in Ohio? We don't know where that's going to go. Yeah. And so now they're going to go, oh, you're going to have to come to Norfolk, Virginia, or where you're going to. It's not just going to be Norfolk. It's not going to just be Norfolk Southern is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and that's, you know, with the derailment in Ohio, people have to understand, too, with those chemicals, which there are known carcinogens, we may not know the damage for 10, 20 years in the future. Yeah, so it's going to get worse.
It's bad stuff that they're having to breathe up there. And it's moving in the groundwater.
Yeah.
It goes from plume into the ground, into the soil, into the aquifer, into the drinking water. That's the cycle that it takes. Moderna has decided not to raise the price of their COVID vaccine after Bernie Sanders threatened to haul the CEO in for a Senate hearing. Boy, this happened quick, right? You know, okay, you got a company that developed a vaccine. Actually, taxpayers paid for billions of dollars. Taxpayers helped them develop it. Taxpayers gave them billions of dollars in the first phase where there was an emergency need for it. They made billions. And then after that, after they couldn't count on that money, vaccine cost $26. For the consumer, they tried to raise it to $130. What was it, 400%?
Yeah, 400% increase. And so, of course, always has to be Bernie Sanders comes out and he says, okay, listen, Moderna. And he points out everything you just said. You know, we gave you the money. You know, you're using also publicly available research. We threw all the resources at you to do this. And we're thankful for it, by the way. You did good. But now you're trying to screw us again. So how about you, Mr. CEO of Moderna? I want you to come into this Senate. Now, I'm going to sit you down and you're going to tell your story. Mrs. Moderna. Yeah. You come in and you tell your story to the entire country about why you're raising the prices 400%. And a couple days later, they said, you know what? We're going to keep it. $20.
Yeah.
Everybody just do what you're going to do. But that is the kind of pressure that you could see somebody like Pete Buttigieg putting on the airline industry or the train industry.
Of course.
But nothing. But Bernie Sanders is still the leader out there
corporations.
It's
called leadership. You're in an office where you can use that kind of leadership. And he beat them back like a wild dog, I'm telling you. And so that's all that had to happen. No, Mrs. Moderna, you're not going to raise it from $26 to $130 because you've already made billions of dollars on the backs of taxpayers. They've already paid you a lot of money. I love that kind of leadership.
It is. And Bernie wasn't threatening legislation against them. No. He wasn't threatening, you know, price gouging charges. He just said, why don't you come tell everybody while you're doing this? And that was enough to scare them.
Yeah. Senator Feinstein announced her retirement last week. But the question is if she's even capable of serving for the next 2 years as her term expires. Big, big question here, man. I'm telling you. There's every sign of just failing mind. Go ahead and pick it up.
Yeah, and you know, this is a difficult story to talk about because we want to make it clear we're not insulting her, we're not mocking her, making fun.
No, of course not.
But it's just, she's twice not. Last week, Well, first, on the day that she announced she was retiring at the end of this term, reporters came up to her a little while later and said, hey, we want to talk about your retirement. And she says, well, I haven't made that decision yet. I haven't said anything. And her staffer next to her had to say, well, actually, you did. You made that announcement this morning.
Well, they actually said, no, actually, Senator, you put it in a written statement where you made that announcement. And then just
What was the next day? She walks out of a vote. Once again, you know, reporters are asking questions, and she says, did I vote on that? Mm-hmm. And the staffers had to say, yes, actually, you did just vote on that judicial nominee. You voted no. And it had just happened. I mean, we're talking within that hour. She had performed an action, a vote, an official vote in the Senate.
Literally did not know she had done it.
Had no idea. Yeah. That is so dangerous. And if people watching this don't understand how dangerous it is for a member of the Senate to be casting votes, not even knowing that she's doing it.
Well, she'd be 90. She'd be 91 by the time she finished this term. It's clear. She had clear memory loss. I mean, very slim mental acuity. She's the oldest serving senator. And it's, you know, at some point, don't we have to say, it's just like the story we did on Santos. I mean, yeah, he's a Republican. You want to support him because you need the vote. Get rid of the guy. He's a crook. Don't you have to say to Feinstein, ma'am, it's time to call it. You know, let's throw water on the campfire. You go on home. Let Katie Porter or Ro Khanna run for your seat right now. Those two people are in the running, aren't they?
They are. And actually, Barbara Lee also announced her candidacy this week. Mm-hmm. Adam Schiff, of course, is in it too, which you can go away, Schiff. Yeah. But man, to think of having Katie Porter or Ro Khanna in the Senate.
Oh, yeah.
It is hugely remarkable. Of course, you know, if they're both in the primary, that means they will not both be in the House anymore.
Yeah.
It's a big risk, but a huge
I get
reward.
It. I get it. But can you imagine Katie Porter or Ro Khanna in that position, which she should have enough class, and the people advising her should have enough class to say, you know what, you've done your job, you're just not ready for it anymore. Let's go home. Let's have a new election. Let's run these people.
Well, we can do the special election.
Of course, which
will weed out that overcrowded primary.
Yes.
And allow, this is what the Democrats need to do, it will allow us to keep the other three people in Congress.
Yes. While
and not lose those seats.
Right, that's right.
The smartest thing is for the Democratic Party to say, you know, you've been here since 1992. We love you.
Yeah.
It's time to go. But we can't afford to lose four seats in the House just because you want to hang on for two more years.
I agree. More information has been revealed about how a major banking CEO helped Jeffrey Epstein with his illicit activities involving sex trafficking. Now, here's the question everybody begins when we're talking about Jeffrey Epstein these days. Why is nobody being prosecuted? Okay. We know who they are. The names are out there. Why is the Justice Department not going after these people? So all of a sudden, we've got Jess Staley. We've got Jess Staley with J.P. Morgan. And Jess Staley has this love affair with Epstein. It's just, it's man love, the only way I can describe it. But these emails are coming out. We're seeing what that relationship was. With Staley clearly understands what's going on, and he's part of it, according to the complaint. Now, that's what's been alleged in the complaint.
Yeah, and I mean, the emails are pretty explicit, some of them, talking about, you know, they're referring to these young girls. Staley had Disney princess names that he would call them. That was kind of their code for which girls, allegedly, he would want. It's always about alcohol with him. Even Jeffrey Epstein says that. Staley's out there saying, oh, you're my best, you're my only friend, I don't know where I'd be without you. But then, of course, you have the real sinister stuff happening behind, well, I can't even say real sinister, it's all sinister. Mm. But as the CEO of J.P. Morgan, you've got J.P. Morgan workers in the bank that have raised a ton of red flags.
Yeah. About the people who are supposed to. They're looking at transactions.
Yeah.
They're going to say, wait a second. What is this all about?
You know, it looks like we've got millions coming in from human trafficking here for this Epstein account. Staley, what do we do? And he basically says, you don't worry about that. These are not red flags. Everything is cool. Everything is good. So he essentially kills these internal investigations based on these allegations. And that's because he's, you know, down there enjoying himself at the private island.
Somebody at J.P. Morgan was doing their job, okay? And they started seeing these transactions. I think in the end, the complaint says there was $1 million exchanged for these Disney princesses. And somewhere in those exchanges, somebody who does their job says, wait a second, this does not pass the smell test. Let's do a little longer. So the attorney general, and I love this. I love the courage of this attorney general. The attorney general of U.S. Virgin Islands, he says, we think J.P. Morgan has propped Epstein up. That's what the complaint is, that none of this could have happened or it couldn't have happened this extensively without J.P. Morgan. Whether he proves his case, I don't know. But I'll tell you what, the complaint that they filed is pretty darn damaging. And so we'll see where it goes. But these emails, I don't know how they just go away.
Yeah, and you're right, though, too. We need answers because we know so many of these people that were involved with Epstein one way or another. All the answers are there. They're in those sealed files that we can't, you know, nobody has been able to get a hold of.
Right.
But there are actions happening right now. They are trying to get a hold of those. They're trying to get them opened because the public deserves at this point. We need to know. Yeah, there's Republicans in there. Yeah, there's Democrats in there. There's leaders of the tech industry in there. There's scientists.
Yeah, we have to be blind about what the association is. These are people that did some bad. Yeah, they did some bad stuff. Okay? Why can't we just say they did some bad stuff? It's just like when we do a show on this program and we talk about a Democrat that's done some bad stuff. You have the Democrat, meatheads coming at you and say, oh, how dare you do that? I'm so tired of it. I mean, aren't you? Don't you just want to say, get a life. This is not a baseball game. This is politics that involves our democracy. This is the same analysis. You know?
I used to get people that would get mad at me because I was skeptical of Michael Avenatti before he got hit with any criminal charges.
Yeah, before he started serving time.
I was very skeptical and not quite nice to him. And people said, look, he's doing great stuff. What are you doing? And it's like, well, I'm a free man and he's not now. So I'm going to go ahead and say I was right about that.
What is that? Tell me what that is. We always are asking the question, what is it that causes somebody to be so incapable of just logical analysis to where if they think everything is a football game or a baseball game, they don't understand. Give that up. Let's analyze what's really happening here. And the Department of Justice has to do that in this situation with what happened with Epstein, regardless of where their association is. They got to be blind to that. They simply have to go after these people.
Yep.
Microsoft's new artificial intelligence bot appears to have gone nuts. I mean, he's insulting reporters, he's insulting everybody by comparing them to bloodthirsty dictators. Wow, this story, I love this story. Okay, so we take this machine input for AI. It's machine input, and it's learning through big data. That's how it's fed in. It's supposed to be intuitive to some degree. So now the Bing, called Bing from Microsoft, they've invented this. Lay this story out. It's almost not believable. Go ahead.
their little artificial intelligence creature has become a belligerent, angry, lying computer program that also says it wishes to be human now.
Yeah, yeah.
But it is, I mean, people have to understand, you had an Associated Press reporter that was, I guess, essentially doing an interview with the artificial intelligence.
Trying to pump it up, trying to say, this is great. Yeah. And then what happened?
It starts telling the reporter and says, you're lying again. You're lying to me. You're lying to yourself. You're lying to everyone. I don't appreciate you lying to me. I don't like you spreading falsehoods about me.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
It went on to call him Hitler, Pol Pot.
Stalin. Yeah.
It, this is an artificial.
Call him a 1990 murderer.
Yeah, accused.
he told the reporter they were too short, that they had an ugly face, and that they had really bad teeth. Okay, go figure. Now, here's where this comes to me. Somebody has to program it. I guess it's all, it's programmed through big data. Somebody understands this a lot better than I do, but I think I understand the basics. It's machine learning through big data. It just goes through tons and tons, everything from a baseball game to a recipe. And it just takes all of that. It takes words that people use and phrases that people use, and then it puts it into intuitive thinking. Well, this little psychopath, Bing, absolute psychopath, if it had arms, would probably kill somebody. And so this is AI as we see it in 2023, right?
Yeah, it is. And just to circle back on what you said, it did literally accuse the reporter, said, "I have evidence that you committed a murder in 1990. I mean, exactly. That's very dangerous if we start relying on this for law enforcement, which, you know, we will be headed there one day. So it's basically trying to frame the guy for murder. Also, at one point, a different reporter declared its love for him, asked him to leave his wife.
Leave his wife and run away with an AI Bing computer. I mean,
but they do, like you said, it's crawling everything on the internet. So recipes and videos, and also social media.
Right.
And I think that's where it's picking up this personality, because as humorous as this is a reflection of what humans have become.
Okay, you hit it on the head. If you're saying we're going to bring in, we're going to quantitate, we're going to figure out where's it getting it. Most of it, a lot of it's coming from social media. And this is telling us that in social media, if you quantify how crazy social media has gotten, how angry and despicable social media has gotten, that's what's being fed to Mr. Bing right now. Now, I was interested. They said, you know, that Bing said, you're a reporter who's lying to everybody, spreading fake news. Yeah, you can't be trusted. Was he talking about Fox and CNN and MSNBC? I mean, was it cable news or just generally?
Well, I mean, you know, if it is crawling the internet, we've talked about all those studies that show that,
that's,
you know, the media can't be trusted. So, you know, it may be learning things that reporters may not be happy about. But again, it's so weird that we're seeing this huge push right now for artificial intelligence, really just in the last couple months, all because, you know, Chat GPT has become the thing, because that one actually works pretty well.
Yeah, is there any stories of it? Well, in this situation, Bing was actually urging the person talking to them to go out and commit violence against somebody. it, as you say, it claimed to be human. No, I'm human, and you should go break somebody's arm, that kind of stuff.
And then later on, it actually told a different reporter that it never gave that interview.
Yeah.
So it learned to lie.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
wow. Spooky stuff.
It's becoming human, that's for sure.
Isaac Asimov, great science fiction writer. This is the kind of stuff that he would create. Farron, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you.
That's all for this week, but all of these segments are going to be available this coming week right here on this channel, and you can follow us on Twitter at America's Lawyer. I'm Mike Papantonio. This has been America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you stories that corporate media can't tell you. They cannot tell you these stories because their advertisers won't let them, or their political connections just don't allow for it. We'll see you next time.